Welcome to the second episode of the ANCX Forum. With the world around us turned upside down, we hope to be able to bring together stakeholders, experts, and insiders of various sectors to help us navigate the post-quarantine scenario. Here, they will recall their experiences during the quarantine, help us craft solutions, and visualize the future of our society. To test or not to test. And we are fortunate to be able to have as co-presenter Art Rocks. And we have with us the founder of Art Rocks himself, Dr. Steve Lim.
All right. Hi. My name is Dr. Steve Lim. I'm a urologist by profession. I work both in St. Luke's, Quezon City and Global. And I'm also the founder of Art Rocks. Now, for those who are not familiar with Art Rocks, it's a vibrant thread which started about 8 years ago with a collection of all the art collectors in the Philippines now. Now, in this time of COVID, these collectors, which composed of businessmen, businesswomen, lawyers, public servants, wanted to pitch in. So early in this COVID crisis, we were able to raise around 15 million pesos to buy these test kits. And these were all given to private and government hospitals like PGH, St. Luke's, Medical City, Asian. Now, we did further on this. We also tried to raise more funds through a sister thread, which is Art for Life. We were also able to raise millions of donations to buy and donate PPEs, masks, alcohol. And now we're into giving food packs to communities. We have already given 250 packs to San Juan, another 500 to Quezon City, ongoing 500 to Muntinlupa and Alabang. Now, in light with the government plans to open up our economy, I have been deluged with a lot of queries by my fellow art rockers. These are like the businessmen. How do we open up? What are the tests to do? No? So, of course, this businessman want to kickstart the workforce to some form of normalcy. So thus this webinar was created. This will hopefully enlighten us on the two main COVID tests available, including what test and when is the best time to use it. I want to disclose that I am not affiliated with any form of company which sells these test kits, nor I am endorsing any of these test kits. Now, may I introduce our special speaker and friend? He is a fellow of Philippine College of Physicians. He is a fellow of the Philippine Society of Microbiology and Infectious Diseases. He is an active consultant, Section of Infectious Disease, Department of Medicine, both in St. Luke's and Global City. He is also the Assistant Chair, Department of Medicine in St. Luke's Medical Center. Introducing Dr. Cristobal Dumo Jr.
Thank you, Steve. And good evening to everyone. All right. So first off, I'd like to thank ANCX Forum and Art Rockers for allowing me to share my experience with COVID-19, how it was to be one of the frontliners. And in fact, one of the many questions that have come my way was, why is it that we are being tested? And the other side of the question is, why are we not being tested? So when Steve approached me and said, I'm a little confused, should I be tested or not? Would you want to discuss this in a webinar? I readily said yes, because I'd like to share what I know about COVID-19 and what I know about testing. So hopefully at the end of the webinar, you're able to understand which test is better for a particular situation. And of course, as we return to the new normal, what's the role of COVID-19 testing as we proceed with the plan to reopen business and our society. Okay, the next slide will really show you the extent of the pandemic. As of last night, exactly around 1 a.m. today, there are close to 5 million cases, and the mortality rate has really gone up from the earlier estimates of 2.5%. It's gone up to 4%, to 5 to 7, and surprisingly, if you notice, the number of deaths really is 14% of the total number of cases. That is much higher than SARS-CoV-1. So we have a far more contagious virus and a far deadlier virus than SARS. Perhaps not as deadly as MERS-CoV, which is 40% mortality, but certainly 14% is a bit too high. In the Philippines, as of last night, we had close to 13,000 cases, and our mortality rate is much better than the global mortality rate at 6.5%. Now, please do remember that these figures are up to rise as we continue to test. So our central question right now is, how aggressive should we go in terms of testing? Before we tackle testing, we need to understand why we have this question. Bakit nga ba? Why are we being asked to justify certain decisions? I'm sure everyone has heard DOLE and DOH saying, no, you don't need to test your employees when they return for work. So why is the decision so? And we'll tell you later, okay? I'll just go through very quickly the impact of COVID-19 globally. And as you can see, the major markets globally, and that includes China, UK, Japan, and of course, US, they've now shown negative growth of their GDP. And you can just imagine, 1 month of closure and they've forecasted negative growth for the first quarter of the year. So that's how large the impact is of the COVID virus. Of course, I know all of you are frequent travelers. You can see the number of flights really dropped from, and the number right now is bare minimum for the airline industry. Next slide, please. We'll also now show the impact beyond finance. Schooling has stopped for our children. Our infrastructure has also stopped. Our healthcare industry has also stopped. We've stopped seeing our patients who need vaccination, who need maintenance follow-up with us for those with chronic medical conditions. And of course, elective surgeries. And all of this has had a huge impact on the financial side of the healthcare sector. So you can just imagine, okay? So, and then of course, you have this famous NBA stars who now are sitting idly by and waiting for society to reopen so that also they can play and start earning some money for themselves. The next slide will show you the common tests that are employed by our hospitals as we speak. Okay. So all of you are familiar with the two tests that have been frequently described, not just by your friends who at one point in time may have been asked to go through the tests. Some of them are more painful than others. Some of them are more unsightly than others. But there are, in general, two types of tests, okay, that are employed to diagnose SARS-CoV. And I'd like to dwell in them in some detail. Okay, so the first one, as you can see, is a test of viral RNA. Viral RNA is the nuclear material of the cell of the virus. So it is amplified a million times, and if it's present, then it's labeled positive. Okay, so one piece, it's very sensitive. If you amplify it, becomes positive, and then you are labeled as COVID confirmed. Now, we know this as COVID swab. So the specimen really is a sampling of your nose. It's unsightly, it's painful, and few people really relish the idea of being tested for viral RNA. Okay. The technology is what we call reverse transcriptase PCR, polymerase chain reaction. So that's PCR. It's able to detect a very small levels of virus in diagnosing COVID. Now, like I said, it detects viral RNA. A key caveat of that is because it tests viral RNA, while it detects the virus, it is not able to distinguish if your virus is dead or alive, because dead virus contain RNA. So that's the weakness of the PCR. And that weakness has to be brought up again when we try to interpret how we should test our patient and our workers as they come back to the office. The other one really tests the immune system, and that's what we call serology. Okay, so it's a blood test. It's a blood test, but it's very similar to your pregnancy kit. If you will take a look at the picture, it says COVID-19, the picture downstairs. It's really very similar to your pregnancy test. You put a drop of blood. The C should have a band. If there's no band, medyo kulang yung blood. Okay, so if your test has a band, that means you have COVID-19. Okay? Or you may have had COVID-19. Because what does it measure? It measures the amount of antibodies. Okay, so when you get infected, for a time you don't get any antibody. Okay? After some time, your immune system kicks in and develops certain types of antibodies, and they show up in your blood. This is what's being tested by serology. This serology test may be rapid, such as this case. Now you can do it at the bedside, parang pregnancy test, or it can be lab-based as well. Now, the more sensitive ones, the ones we call ELISA test. Now, this require machines. It takes around a day or two to come out with the result. But generally, they are far more sensitive than the quick tests, yung tinatawag namin RDTs, rapid diagnostic tests. These are the ones that are very similar to your pregnancy test. But I just like to put the two together, okay? Try to show you where the virus comes in, where it disappears, and when your antibody comes in, okay? The dotted vertical line, the black dotted vertical line, is the day you start having symptoms. Okay, so before the symptom onset, your virus will be unlikely to be tested or detected. Except in the very latest studies, they have shown that 2 to 3 days before you develop symptoms, your PCR is likely to pick up virus. So it will turn positive. So remember, you don't have symptoms, you test, and then after 2 days, you start having symptoms. If you test when you have symptoms, your PCR will likely be positive. However, so that's your PCR likely positive, and that's your white field bar at the top that says PCR likely positive. At the end of the third week, the virus will be undetectable and your PCR will be negative. So let's take a look at your immune system. The immune system refers to the dotted line in the line graph. Don't look at the bar, but look at the line graph. Okay. So your purple line is really what we call immunoglobulin M. So M is the purple line. The green one is your immunoglobulin G. So it's easier to remember. M is maaga, so it rises earlier. if you will notice that the when you go to the right over time, your purple line, which is IgM, the one that rises earlier, drops off. Maybe give it about a week or two, it drops off and gives way to persistent elevations in your IgG. So yung G is the one that lasts. That supposedly gives you lifelong immunity. We don't know if that's the case with SARS-CoV-2, the virus responsible for COVID-19. But certainly, it seems to be the case for SARS-CoV-1 and even Ebola. Okay? So you have some measure of protection for maybe a couple of years, after which your IgG drops off and you now become susceptible to another round of infection. We don't know if that's the case with COVID SARS-CoV-2. So if you put PCR, which is a test of the virus, and your antibody levels, you can clearly see that at the end of about, it's sometime in the middle of the second week, when you test serology, you will become positive. Okay? ELISA, or the ones, the tests that are done at the lab, are able to distinguish between IgG and IgM. Above a certain level of IgG, we tell you, okay, you're now recovered from COVID-19. If you have both IgM and IgG being positive, hindi ka pa fully recovered, you're on your way. Your IgM has to disappear and your IgG has to stay in order for us to conclude na, okay, you've recovered from your viral infection. But I'd like you to notice the overlap between the bars, which says PCR likely positive, and the bar that says antibody positive. There's a significant overlap. And this is, I think, one that's confused a lot of people. You know, they tested positive. Dalawang buwan na silang may sakit, dalawang buwan na silang magaling, they're still in isolation, and they can never get a PCR negative. But if you test their blood, okay, because now they tire out of being swabbed every week, they say, ayoko na, masakit na yung ilong ko. You get a blood test, they get IgG positive. So now you ask the question, eh bakit hindi pa negative ang PCR? That's where the dead virus comes in. Is the virus dead at which particular window period? Okay, that's the window. That's the window where it says you are PCR positive and you are also antibody positive. So hindi mo alam at which point in time in that window you are truly recovered. That's where it's a little dicey, because if you compare the US guidance, their CDC versus our Department of Health guidance, magkaiba ang return to work of a patient who has been infected. I'll go through that later. Okay, but remember this, there is that window that's caused us so much pain. Patients have been well for over 14 days. They still have swab positive, but they're also antibody positive. So what the heck? They're still in the hospital. Okay. Okay, so the next slide will actually tell you and summarize, I'll try to put in everything together. No? Kasi I realize a lot of the listeners here may have little medical background. So I'll try to make this very very easy for everyone, and also to put everything together. So in essence, there are the SARS-CoV-2 tests that we have available. In summary, have two targets of testing. Your PCR or your swab, your nose swab, detects the virus, but it cannot differentiate if it's dead or alive. Your antibody detects naman, the blood test detects immune response, the presence of antibodies. Now remember, like I said, your antibody only appears if you've been exposed. Right? So at any point in time, if all you test is a blood test, your antibody test, it will not tell you if you have active infection. Why? Kasi antibody is protective. So if you test positive for antibody, that means protected ka, but you don't know, protected from a long time ago or 2 weeks ago. We don't know. We're not able to differentiate that using the antibody test. Remember your issue on Dengvaxia, that's the antibody test. It's very similar to your antibody test in Dengvaxia. Okay, secondly, these two tests help us define in some sort of way the phases of infection. Okay, what do we mean by that? If you have PCR positivity, likely infected ka. Pero hindi namin alam. Are you at the tail end of that infection when the virus is dead? Or at the start? We don't know. Lalo na if you don't have symptoms. It's good if you have symptoms kasi we're able to say, ah, okay, the day you develop symptoms, that means 2 days before that, meron ka ng virus in your body. More or less. Okay? Now, the exposure side of infection, meaning you encountered the virus, whether in the last month or let's say if we're speaking next year, last year, let's say 2021, nag-antibody testing ka, positive, you'll say, ah, baka na-expose ako last year. So it's able to say, your antibody testing is able to say, you've been exposed, but we don't know if you have active infection. Okay. And now if you take the two together, if they're both positive, then you say, ah, baka nasa recovery window ako. I'll stop here and pause for a while. I don't know if any one of you has this experience. Positive, positive ang swab, nag-negative, and then nag-positive. Please don't conclude that you were reinfected. Anywhere you look at the data, and when I say data, scientific data, data that's been published in reputable journals, we have not seen reports of documented reinfection. Okay, so wala pa. We don't know if it will happen because the data on COVID-19 is evolving. It's a new virus that's circulating in the human population. So we don't know. But as of the moment, the data seems to say no reinfection. Okay, pwede ba yun, Doc? Ay, unahan ko na yung tanong niya. Pwede ba talaga na dead virus yun kahit yung PCR mo positive? I'll go back to one of our nemesis. We'll go back to TB. Okay. How do we diagnose TB? We use the same methodology, PCR. We try to look for TB bacilli in your sputum using PCR. When you're diagnosed, to have TB via PCR, we never test you for cure using PCR. Why? Because dead bacilli test positive for PCR. So at the end of 2 months, when we start lowering the dose, the number of medicines for TB, we don't use PCR. What we look for is a different test. So it's the similar phenomenon for PCR testing for COVID-19. Pag gumaling ka na, may time na PCR positive ka pa rin. But you should not fret kasi likely dead virus yun. Okay. I hope that's clear. And then, of course, the tests have different timelines kasi different methodologies. Your PCR has to be done at the lab. Okay? When I was training in fellowship, matagal na yon, huwag niya nang tanongin, baka lukohin pa ho ako ni Steve. Okay? We were the first ones to actually start doing PCR. And it's really laboratory-based. It takes some time. In the US, actually, it takes just a day or two. But here, for a while, it took us 12, 18 days before it's released. Now, it takes around 2 days na lang, ano? They try to bunch it up together because it's really an expensive test. And of course, there's a rapid test. No? And you can do this in the clinic. Okay, please don't do this like a parang pregnancy test. Ha? Kasi really, it has to be a doctor that has to do this. The pregnancy test is what we call a lateral flow test. Talagang nag-flow yung blood on the side. Kaya lateral. Okay? So, they detect antibody versus SARS-CoV-2. And there have been in development new viral antigen tests. No? Ito ang dinedetect niya yung virus mismo, hindi lang yung antigen. And they're saying you can do this actually in the clinic. It's not lateral flow. You use cassettes, you use a drop of blood, and it's able to detect. So, but it's still in its earliest stages, but the data really looks very good for this test. So, you cannot imagine how fast things are moving in COVID-19. It's not just vaccines, it's not just the drugs, but the testing as well. Okay? And of course, there's a lot of fake news as well. So please be very careful of what you read, be it in the TV or what you see on TV or read in the papers or on the internet. There's no Dr. Google, okay? I have to say. So I hope that's very clear, okay? So I'll just finish my discussion on testing by saying, by taking a look at the entire cycle of infection from the start of the virus being discovered to the first cases of infection and then to overt disease and recovery. So where do we do this test? Obviously, the red bar. So when you get infected, anong kailangan natin gamitin? Parang exam, ano? Yung PCR. Kasi it detects the virus. Tama? You don't use antibodies. So when you recover, ideally, antibodies. Pero may caveat nga, di ba? We have to make sure that you don't have virus. Remember, you have antibody, but for some time, you may still have some virus, at the end of which, dead na yung virus, pero at the start of the window, meron pang live virus yun eh. Okay? And that is why they're saying you should not rely solely on antibodies. And if you will take a look at the DOH guidance, it says, if you test for IgG antibodies, dapat sana at least one PCR is negative. Kasi you want to make sure you're not infective. Okay, that's very important. I'd like you to take a look at the epidemiological surveillance because this is where I think most of the question is. As we go back to business, who do we test? When do we test? Ito na yung tinatawag namin epidemiological surveillance. Before you develop disease, how do you test? Ito yung question natin. Should you use PCR? Should you use antibodies? I think the answer is there. Dalawa. Okay? But it's also reflective of the preference. Okay? We prefer the PCR at this stage, actually, over antibodies. Because we're at the earlier stages of the pandemic. As we move forward, we will surely, I think, take a closer look at the role of antibodies later on. Okay? But for the moment, PCR seems to be much preferred at the earlier stages of the cycle, but certainly antibodies at the tail end. Okay? All right, I hope that's very clear to everyone. Okay, the next slide actually will just share with you snippets of the guidance on new normal, whether it's in the Philippines or in the US. So I'll just start off by saying that when you bring people back to work, testing is a small part of everything. Okay. When you start thinking about, for those of you who own business, if you have to start your business, make sure that you've covered everything. Elimination, substitution, engineering controls, administrative controls, and the last, personal protective equipment. Ito yung mga gown masks. While it is the focus of a lot of attention, even in the hospital, this same hierarchy of controls applies. Okay? The PPE it's not ineffective. We're saying it's least effective kasi you spend an enormous amount of resources pero yung control niya is not as yung impact as large as a simple elimination control activity. And I'll give you an example. Okay? When you come in, when workers come in, the concept of symptom screening is the sample of elimination. Because by eliminating from physical access, patients or subjects rather, I'm sorry, workers, your workers with symptoms, possible symptoms of COVID, you're able to protect the remaining employees and your company. That's how effective symptom control is. And that's why later on at the end of the discussion, makikita nyo yung question on how to which to test and when becomes secondary na lang. Kasi we always say symptom screening is much more important at this point in time than routine testing. And I'll discuss that further. Okay, so this is the latest DOH guideline on return to work. If you will clearly see, there's a lot of activities, no? Making sure your office is clean. Okay, there's opportunity for one to clean hands anywhere he goes. So entrance hanggang meeting room hanggang pauwi. Okay, there's a look at your ventilation. There's a provision for infection control activities such as sinks for hand washing. And then if you notice, in large part, if you read the entire document, parang pinagtuunan niya ng pansin is symptoms. And you will clearly see, okay? Daily temperature and symptom check. You have to do that. You have to really do that every day. It has to be recorded, okay? You make sure that anyone with symptoms or travel history or exposure history has to be reported before they go into your office, okay? It's very similar to how we do it in the clinic. As we return to the clinic, ganun din yung ginagawa namin, okay? It's the same set of rules. So it applies to business as well, okay? And look where testing comes in. A very, very small reminder at the end of the document. It says, you do not need to test routinely. But, you know, I highlighted, may test a sample, representative sample. Which group? Everyone ba? Hindi, di ba? It's the high-risk group. Okay. And I'll explain later. The next slide. The next slide is from the US. And this is current. Okay. For those of you who do not like how it's being done in the US, set that aside. But look at this particular guidance because this one acknowledges what we call risk-based control activities. So what do we mean by that? For all your workers, you have to label each one of them according to your exposure risk category. Okay. I'll start off with high exposure risk. These are the ones with real potential exposure to confirmed or probable COVID-19 cases. Ito yung mga health workers. Okay. Pero there's a very special subset of healthcare workers which are very high exposure risk. And these are the ones, ito yung mga nurses natin, yung mga nag-nebulize, yung mga nagbibigay ng medications to their patients. Because by performing their job, the riskier transmissions happen. And the riskier transmissions are aerosol. Remember, COVID-19 is droplet. Hindi ho yan parang TB na aerosol. Okay? So, these healthcare workers, when they work, they elicit certain activities na instead of droplet lang, pati ang aerosol transmission nasasalubong nila. And these are your nurses. These are the ones, the respiratory specialists. These are the ones that are very high exposure risk. If you look at medium exposure risk, because we now have sustained the community transmission, anyone with close contact with the general public, and I don't know what your business is, but try to envision which of your office mates or which part of your department or your entire business is customer facing. And when we say close contact, that is by definition 15 minutes spent with a customer at least 6 feet, less than 6 feet from the employee. So if you have that employee, she is medium exposure risk. And of course, low exposure risk, no contact with COVID-19. Why is this important? So the next slide will show you how it's applied in the Philippine setting. So this is the latest risk categorization by the DOH. I'll just summarize, okay? Subgroup A has to be tested now. Subgroup B, later. Subgroup C, if you reach a certain level of tests available for that population in the locality. Okay, here it says 8,000, but that's something you can decide for yourself. Okay, so in rank order, priority ang A over B, over C, over D. So A is one with, it doesn't care whether you're a patient or a healthcare worker, if you have severe symptoms, meaning malapit ka, kailangan mong ma-ICU, abay, kailangan kang matest. Subgroup B, if you have mild symptoms, pero may travel ka or vulnerable population. So that means, I don't know who of you are 65 years old, if you have diabetes, and then you probably are a COVID suspect, you need to be tested because you belong to subgroup B. Subgroup C, mild symptoms lang. Subgroup D, walang symptoms. So asymptomatic but with probable exposure. Okay, pag walang exposure, kita nyo, wala siyang priority, right? So you have to ask yourself, do we really need to test your employees na wala namang exposure? So you have to think about that, okay? Okay, how about the US? Okay, so that's how we categorize. Okay, so by risk, if you have excess capacity, then you try to test the ones with milder symptoms. How about in the US? So this is really high risk, ano? If you will see, ito diagnosed na, kasi positive ito, symptomatic. They still use testing, and it's PCR. If you notice, the ones on the negative results, for two consecutive specimens. That's your swab. But if you notice, they put in above test-based, what? Symptom-based. So they're saying, symptoms alone, pwede ka nang sabihin, pwede na. Okay. What does this tell you? It tells you that even in the US, because they're also short of testing kits, even they're saying, we have to be risk-based. That's all I'm saying for this slide. It has to be risk-based. Everything is risk-based. Next slide. The next slide is asymptomatic healthcare worker na nag-test positive. Nasaan ang test-based? Second pa rin. Priority pa rin ang time-based strategy. Okay? So it really is, you choose one over the other. What I'm saying is, let's not focus too much. Let's not rely too much on tests and what the results are. Because if you do so, I guarantee you, our response to the pandemic will fail. It will fail. Okay. And so what should we do? Here in the Philippines, this is the DOH guidance on how we should test our patients. Okay. So PCR is used if you're suspecting acute infection. That's the RT-PCR, the second column. Okay, so symptomatic individuals have to be tested with PCR. You don't use your antibody test if you notice. Okay. Now, at the time of recovery, that's when probably you should be using your IgG. Again, I'm saying probably because the preference still for the DOH is a two negative, use of PCR. If PCR availability is an issue, then you can use IgG, your antibody test. Okay? So the question, should we conduct mass testing? Okay. The arrow should be on the one to the right of the total test. So I just put in the most significant countries. Okay. It essentially says that, so you know, I put in US, China, because that's where it came from. And the ones we would like to be used as a reference would be Singapore, because they're very good with their management of COVID-19, and Taiwan, our neighbor to the north. Okay. I'll just tell you that in terms of density of testing, so that means tests versus 1 million population, that's the column beside the total tests. It's about 2,000 plus, it's very similar to Taiwan, versus Singapore, which is 42,000 tests per million patients, per million population. So what we're saying is, in Singapore, they've done a lot more tests. So the density of testing is much higher compared to Philippines and Taiwan. So ang question natin, should we attempt something like Singapore? The broad answer is yes, but it has to take on a different flavor. So what do you mean by that? So who and how do we test? Very obvious, patients who are COVID suspects, so symptomatic, have to be tested. In order of preference, severe, followed by mild, vulnerable, diba? Group A. Group B is mild, vulnerable, and group C is mild. And the test of choice is swab or PCR. So because it detects the virus. For those who are recovering na confirmed COVID-19 cases, we still need to test them. Hindi mo naman sila pwedeng pabayaan kasi we're still in the early parts of the pandemic. Okay? Where possible, you do PCR. There's debate whether you need two consecutive or one. I tend to think one is good enough for as long as you combine that with antibody tests. And the tests have to be, like we said, IgG positive kasi yan yung long-term, and IgM negative, lampas ka na doon sa window period. Tama? Okay. And this is where the concept of mass exposure risk-based testing comes in. Okay? So in order of preference, inverted pyramid siya. Okay? This is your return to work, di ba? Yung society. You don't test everyone. You test according to their risk category of getting COVID-19. So, if your subject is a healthcare worker in contact with COVID and performing high-risk lab or nursing procedures, yan po ang very high-risk patient. That's subject, rather. That's the one you should test. So if you own a laboratory, all your workers should be tested. Secondly, they're followed by healthcare worker or personnel in contact with public. And when I say in contact with public, on a sustained basis, less than 6 feet apart, for more than 15 minutes, lalo na ho kung hinahawakan ang public, anyone in public, that person has to be tested. I have to say that any one person is, all of us are COVID suspect. In essence, everyone has to be regarded as possibly harboring COVID. Okay, that is why the concept of symptom screening comes in. When you do exposure risk-based testing, this has to be in conjunction with all the other sorts of controls. Okay, hindi mo papapasukin kalahati ng opisina, kalahati telemedicine, para yung exposure is only half. Doon sa kailangan pumasok, tanggalin mo lahat ng may symptoms para only the healthy ones are in the office. You only let the ones who are symptomatic in after a certain period of time. You just have to refer to the DOH guidance. For those in the office, sino ang pinaka-at risk of COVID transmission? Ito na yung mga yung kailangan mong i-test. Okay? Then you try to test them. Not all of them. It's preferable if you can do all of them, pero it's expensive. So you can just do representative samples. That's why I go back to the first statement ng DOH, which says, may test for a representative sample of the high-risk group. This is the explanation, the last slide. Okay? And because of this, because you're looking for the virus, kasi ito yung natatransmit, what test do you use? PCR. Okay, so I hope that this particular set of slides have given you sufficient understanding of testing, what it tests, when it tests positive, and who should be tested both in the earlier pandemic stages and now as we try to return to business in the broader society. Okay, so I guess at this point we can open up the session to questions, Steve and Cez.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dumo. Well, we have one text in question, but before I go there, you're essentially saying, because there has been a mad rush for the rapid tests, rapid antibody tests by businesses. Are you saying that is unnecessary kung asymptomatic? But let me go to that first question na rin because it's related. Should any test be done? This is from Lorena Cabaluna. Should any test be done on asymptomatic prior to return to work?
Okay. I'll give a long answer because I'll say that in the entire spectrum of COVID disease, 80% will be symptomatic. So your focus is on the 20%. The 80% symptomatic, if you take a look at the data we have a, from all the number of tests that we've done, they've been able to pick out positive in 5% of cases. And remember, our testing has almost always been symptomatic. So the data we have for the 13,000 cases is mostly symptomatic. And it's a 5%, let's say, efficiency. Okay. Imagine if you try to collect much more testing data, which now includes the asymptomatic, which is the 20%. Plus yung hindi talaga walang COVID. So if you test all of them because you want them to come back to the office, imagine the number of tests that you will perform. It's going to really cost you a lot. It's not really cost effective. Okay. Plus, so that's the first.
Plus it doesn't serve any purpose really.
Yes.
Rapid antibody test.
That's PCR. Lalo na yung rapid antibody test. Because rapid antibody test only tells you that you've been exposed. But I really don't know if you still have the virus or you met the virus last December or January. But I'd like to say, you're asking, bakit kaya December? No? You know, we've had a number of cases in the first part of January that look suspiciously very similar to what we see now in COVID. I had at least 2 or 3 cases. And I tell you, they weren't screened by DOH because they were saying they did not travel to Wuhan. So the community transmission may have been happening much earlier than is reported or acknowledged officially.
You're saying it's not necessary unless they are exposed to the public.
Yes. Yes. Okay. So ganito, if you are, so when you come in, the very first step you must do before you even let them in the office is give them a questionnaire, a health questionnaire. Symptoms. You ask for symptoms of COVID. That includes fever, cough, not so much sore throat, pero yung change in smell, that's a very highly predictive of COVID. Muscle aches. If any of that is ticked, then you tell them you go on quarantine, you consult your physician for testing. Pag nakalusot doon, may second line pa. Did you travel to... Okay. Mahirap na kasi lahat na halos mayroong positive. The third one is, did you come into contact with a COVID confirmed case or took care of a COVID confirmed case? Pag any of the three are positive, that's when you're tested. Everyone else, you now apply risk-based testing. But again, using PCR and not antibody testing. A third note on antibody testing. While I'm saying there's been a number of antibody testing available, I'm not sure all of them are approved by the FDA. So the first thing you ask is, ito ba okay sa ating FDA? Because a lot of them are not too reliable. And I'll tell you, one of the doctors I know tested antibody tests from different countries. Ayoko na sabihin kung alin ang kwan, nag-negative. But one of them turned out negative. And they're saying, okay, so it's pretty unreliable at the moment. But I think there are reports that in the coming days, because the sensitivity of antibody tests is less than 60%, so that's bad. You only accept these tests when they're more than 65 or 70% sensitivity. Because they're able to pick up yung cases. Sensitivity is you're able to pick up positive cases. Pag mababa, a negative test doesn't really tell you whether it's really negative. Okay.
All right. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Dumo, for a very extensive lecture. I guess it's a perfect time to ask this because a certain famous businessman named, I don't know him too much, Joey Concepcion, di ko alam kung sino siya. But he says that the doctors are not doing anything, no, about this COVID. And I think he's pushing for the rapid test. How do you respond to this type of allegation that the doctors are not doing anything now and we should push for testing?
Okay. Okay, we're not doing anything. Okay, that's a really a first because I can tell you we barely really had some rest, significant rest because of COVID. You're welcome to visit our hospital. You know, I never imagined St. Luke's would be really overrun by patients. And I can share to everyone that I never in my entire life, and I've been in practice more than 20 years. As you can see, I'm fairly senior. The hair shows it. But I've never seen our emergency room swamped by COVID patients from east to west, and all of them needing to be intubated, sometimes three at the same time. That's an experience we would not want to be repeated, okay? And so I assure you, for anyone who has seen how terrible it was in the early days of COVID, it really is pandemonium. Have we done enough? Probably kulang, kasi we've been really overrun. What we managed was firefighting, making sure that we were able to save those who we could save. And mind you, we don't have effective therapy. So we're running literally blind by using whatever has been shown to be useful in earlier by earlier reports in coming from China. So should we, as a matter of correction, employ massive rapid antibody testing? Firm answer is no, because that is useless. You might as well spend your money on PCR testing for risk-based testing. Risk-based testing is effective. This was the same strategy used to control MERS-CoV and SARS. So it is effective. And we're employing it now, except that Nauna na masyado ang SARS-CoV-2, so but it's just a matter of time before we're able to control it and overtake it with this set of strategies. It will help if people will not flock to the mall, because otherwise you give opportunity for us to be overrun again.
Wait, Doc Steve, what do you mean sa'yo napunta yung question eh. Why are you saying that Joey Concepcion is pushing for rapid tests? Is he?
He is, because that's what the business sector wants. They want to push for this rapid test so that the economy will run. Mm-hmm. But the doctors are the ones stating that this antibody test should not be used as a screening tool.
Okay, may I ask Dr. Dumo, are you aware of the suppliers, favored suppliers of government for these rapid antibody tests? Are there any?
There have been reports. I don't know if they're true. But what I can tell you is that before any rapid antibody test can be deployed, it really has to pass the validation by the Research Institute for Tropical Medicine, because that's the validating institution. When they validate it, then the FDA will tell you, okay, you can use this. Because if you look at the sensitivity data of all these tests, they're hovering around 60%. That's still unacceptable, save for one or two. So I'm sure, but I don't know their...
Well, yes, this is the project mark. This is the Project ARC.
Right, right.
So are the tests in Project ARC below the 60% sensitivity level?
As far as I know, they've tested that for RITM, through RITM. And I was told just very recently that I think late last week that they've been, at least one or two have passed validation. So I don't know which ones of these are the validated ones.
All right, Doc Steve?
Yes. I think I can ask Mike Toma Cruz.
I'm just wondering, is there, because they opened the, they from the ECQ, we're now in a, what is it, MCQ?
Yes.
Modified, you know, and then now they're saying that the cases are going up again. And I'm hearing like all of these things that they're going to declare again another ECQ. Is that necessary?
Now, this I have to say. Flattening the curve doesn't mean we've controlled the virus. It just says that we've been able to prevent the rise. Remember the term, prevent the rise in new cases so that our healthcare system is not overwhelmed. So what it's just saying is that our current capacity for healthcare is able to manage the cases, okay? So if we now reopen, the possibility of another wave really exists. That is why the answer is not ECQ again. But I go back to the lecture I just gave, which is responsible reopening of business. You have to set up your business again. Rethink everything, the way you do business. Instead of everything is customer facing. You know, I was 20 years with pharma industry, and I know customer facing. So I know business. Okay, so you have to rethink everything. Okay? When you say customer facing, it has to be baka virtual customer facing. Kalahati lang kailangan pumasok, or yung manufacturing lang kailangan. Mga ganon. And then when they come in, you make an opportunity for social distancing to be observed at all times, cohorting yung mga mas malaki ang customer-facing experience nila for 1 month versus the others na nasa background lang ng office. Yung mga ganun. So you have to re-engineer your entire business. If you do that, you don't have to go back to ECQ. What I can tell you is because we've been in touch with members of the task force, is that they are on the lookout for any spikes. Okay. And I can assure you that if they see an unusual spike, you will really hear from the IATF and they will surely do an ECQ. But I don't know what their trigger is because it's a bunch of numbers. Numbers I can't even maybe understand fully. But as part of our training in infectious diseases, we're able to say na mukhang tama yung mga ganyan decisions. So hopefully we don't get back to ECQ.
Irving Tan wants to know, what is the update on the Gene Expert Test. What is that?
The Gene Expert Test is a PCR. It's really PCR based, but it's a brand actually. It's TB for, yeah, we have TB Gene Expert. We have also COVID Gene Expert. Irving, I know Irving is my batchmate. Irving, the project on Gene Expert using COVID is chugging along very nicely. We should have the test, I think, available soon for COVID-19. If I'm not mistaken, very, very soon.
All right. Very reliable. From Richard Garcia. As a preventive measure, aside from testing, would UV light help get rid of the virus in a workplace or home?
Yes, I did a similar lecture for doctors. You can actually use UV light, but you have to be very careful because when you employ UV light, may mga shadowing yun eh. Okay? So you have to place your UV light, you have to expose your entire workplace to UV light. So it will take more than a day to do that. And secondly, not all UV light are created equal. There's UV light A, B, and C. A and B are bactericidal, but they are not virucidal. UVC is germicidal and virucidal. So that's the one you like to use. Okay. But we have available, we use it in the hospital as well.
Are they expensive, Doc?
No, not really.
Not really. Doc, di ba meron pang UVC with ozonator? Can you explain on that?
So, they're saying na your ozonator is able to generate ozone to kill bacteria. But even without the ozonator, just use the UVC, you should be good. Because UVC is germicidal. For those who, you know, because we have reused our N95 because of the shortage, we actually use UVC to irradiate our N95, and we can reuse them subsequently. That's very useful.
Is it true that when you do the UVC, it's like a flashlight effect only? Only where the light is exposed, that's where it works. But behind like a door or behind a desk, that won't be able to penetrate that light.
So that's why you really need to reposition everything after a certain period of time. You follow the manufacturer's advice. Make sure all your entire workplace, as in especially the high touch areas, are really reached by UV light.
Isn't the ozonator an addition to that? Because as I understand, UVC kills whatever is affected, but the ozone, which is air, can penetrate the others which are exposed by the light. Is it true?
Ozonator is just an added benefit, but practically it's really UV that's doing the job.
Would you recommend homes to have this UV light?
Yeah.
Okay. If you can afford it, mura lang naman siya, you can do that. But
magkano po yung mura?
Steve, magkano ba binili mo?
Okay. I have a source. I'll PM it to you later, but I don't have any direct affiliation. There are two types of UVC. There's a home which can cover about 30 to 40 square meters. Its cost is only less than 5,000 with 1 year warranty. There is an industrial type which can cover 100 square meter. But you have to be very careful because UVC is dangerous to us. That is why when you buy these UVCs, there has to be a remote control. You put the UVC inside the room, you get out, and you turn by remote the machine, leave it according to whatever is on the manual. It could be 30 minutes, 45 minutes, or an hour. And yet, you cannot enter the room where the UVC is after about an hour. You have to open the windows and expose all the air before it's safe to go in. So if you're going to do this UVCs, I suggest at least two hours to be on the safe side. Now, we've discussed a little bit on the UVC on Artrox because, of course, Artrox is composed of art collectors. And we found out that UVC can affect your artworks. It will fade. So you need to cover this. Now your question is it recommended? Why not? You can buy this. It's fairly cheap. You can buy it for your house. In my personal matter, when we do groceries, we just put it there, put the UVC, and then after about 2 hours, you don't have to disinfect one by one everything. Mm-hmm. It saves a lot of time, and it really kills. That's what we use in the OR.
Okay. Dr. Dumo, okay. A question from your classmate, Irving Tan. Personnel who take mass transpo, at what level of risk will you put them, Doc?
Depends, no? If the mass transpo practices social distancing strictly, then we're okay. But that is close to impossible. You know naman.
So at what risk would they be?
And then we can see it's high risk.
Can they return to work if they are taking mass transpo, Doc?
Exactly. Okay, so they can be labeled at best or at worst rather medium risk, but again I go back to the daily question. So the daily question of do you have symptoms or do you have contact with a confirmed case has to happen every day. So that has to be in place again. Whether you need to test, ako I would probably just observe him. And then if he develops symptoms, that's the time I test. Because remember, this wasn't something I discussed. When you test today, the test is only as good as today. Tomorrow may be another matter. Okay? And we've had cases where they just got the test yesterday and they had symptoms after 4 days. And they're saying, why do I have a... And then they test positive. Because really, like I said, 2 days before you become symptomatic, that's the time your PCR becomes positive. Mm-hmm. So you have to,
okay,
unless you want to do this every day. Yes.
Jeffrey Yu. And I don't know, Drs. Dumo and Dr. Steve, if you have information on this. Is it true that the government is requiring private companies to shoulder employees' hospital costs for COVID infection during MECQ? It's circulating in social media. Yes, I've seen some of these accounts.
Unfortunately, I talked to some attorney friends earlier on Art Rocks. And yes, under the DOLE, I think if the employee is affected with COVID during her tenure of work or his tenure of work, the employer should pay for everything. Mm-hmm. It sagot ng ano talaga ng company. So I pity the company because they're shelling out a lot already. But it's under DOLE that the employers are liable for all their employees.
Well, we will have to confirm that.
Yeah.
Because you are not DOLE. But anyway, the lawyers have told you. Okay. Edwin Lim. Do you require all or just sampling for high-risk workers before reopening? Dr. Dumo.
The DOH guidance and even the DOLE guidance says sampling. But here's the question. Let's say I'm part of your staff and then I'm not screened. Siyempre, hihingi ako, di ba? So while sampling is recommended, ako, I would personally advise na perhaps it would be a good idea because this is really for your staff naman. If you can include those that are really at the higher levels of priority, perhaps you can include all of them. But remember, when you test, that's good in time. That's a point in time surveillance. I failed to mention that if you have to do this, yung question of how frequently becomes another matter. No? So how frequently should you do this? I don't know the answer to that. Okay, some say every week, some say every 3 weeks. There's no science to that answer.
This is a very interesting question from Emil Del Rosario. How could we respond to our clients that are requiring us to conduct rapid testing on all our employees assigned to their properties?
Well, offhand, you can tell them, we can do that, okay? But remember, if we do that, whatever data we have will be useless. Because whether I am IgM negative or positive doesn't really mean anything. It does not, it cannot describe the transmission risk. So I will go back and say that everyone is saying it's a useless test if you want to test your client. And the DOH says really you do risk-based testing. So if we have to do this, what's our interaction with COVID in terms of COVID in that particular agreement? If it's really COVID sensitive, then it's something you need to perhaps arrive at an agreement, which is perhaps you should test. If the risk for COVID secondary to that agreement is very high.
Yes, I would like to call on, I don't see him actually, but he said he's on, Dr. Fabio Posas.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes. Yes, Doc.
Okay. Wonderful. Dr. Dumo.
Yes, sir.
I hear about UV lights. I hear about filters in homes. And but you know, there is something to be said about human exposure to bacteria, viruses, and the immune system, and how we are able to cope with the environment by allowing our immune systems to work and protect us. And too much protection may actually put us at significant risk. Because we know that most patients haven't been exposed to COVID. So the ECQ, basically what it did is just to heat us from the virus, but the virus is still in the environment. Now, we have in the Philippines a population that is an average of 26.7 years. And as of last statistics that I saw, only 8% of the population or so are over 65. I mean, it begs the question about strategies for managing the COVID pandemic in the Philippines as to why not modify it? I mean, if the young population aren't dying from exposure to the virus, why not do a modified exposure so that the individuals who are unlikely to suffer develop, get infected and hopefully develop immunity. And at the same time, we protect the elderly. It's the best way to maintain our economy and at the same time, keep the health of the population while we don't have a vaccine.
Right, Dr. Posas, I think it's something that's been openly discussed. So what we're saying is while on one end, one extreme, you have an ECQ, and the other is what probably UK started discussing, which is herd immunity. I think the correct stance is somewhere in between, where you have enough exposure and enough quarantine to keep things manageable. As to where that is, it's very difficult to ascertain, because really a lot of what the IATF has been doing is based on mathematical models. Meaning at the particular run rate we have, what's it going to look like 1 or 2 weeks from today? And when you do that, it becomes very difficult because the factor of immunity coming in and modifying your model, as Dr. Posas has intimated, becomes very real. I believe in this becoming endemic soon enough, okay, meaning it will become part of our virus mix in the population, and we will probably attain a certain level of immunity, very similar to malaria, where once you have some disease, your malaria symptoms or your COVID symptoms in this case will be a lot better than someone who is not immune in some ways. Like in malaria happening for Caucasians where the disease is much more severe. Suddenly I realized I'm talking to Dr. Posas and the majority of the listeners are non-doctors. So what I'm saying is I also agree with Dr. Posas that at some point when a significant part of the population may have been exposed, either we knowing it or by testing or not. When we reach a significant part of our population and they become immune, the manifestations of COVID as they reflect on the general population may change to one that is milder because you have some sort of immunity. It's similar to what has happened in malaria, where Filipinos experience milder symptoms of malaria versus a person whose country has no malaria and therefore has no level of immunity. And when he develops pneumonia, it's more severe than others. In this case, because it's global, I'm fairly certain after some time, I don't know if it's in a year, 2 or 3 or 4, the symptoms may change, hopefully for the better. But, you know, Dr. Poses, some would say they're not willing to risk that. They would rather get a vaccine now or get a useful drug or totally avoid being exposed at this time. So that's my answer. It's a long answer. It's a yes to Dr. Poses and a yes to ECQ. But I think most of the infectious disease specialists I know would be having the same opinion as mine.
All right. Doctor, here's one question. How do we track down the asymptomatic cases who are low risk and are walking around infecting others? Will they make for an exponential growth?
Okay. This is where the concept of viral load comes in. Okay. And when I say that, when you are asymptomatic but you are positive and you're roaming around spreading the disease, the amount of virus you circulate is noticeably much less than someone who is symptomatic and is in the hospital. Which is why, you know, the phenomenon of healthcare workers, when they get, that's why they're tested first, because the amount of viral load they receive is much, much higher because the patients are sicker and there's a higher viral load. So this is where probably the herd immunity will come in. There's some level of low-level immunity everywhere, all around us, because of these asymptomatic positive cases that have not been detected and who are roaming around infecting everyone. Hopefully, they won't have symptomatic cases, and hopefully, most of them will probably recover and we have this sort of immunity. That's why I was saying today, PCR is very nice, but a year from now, when you discuss antibody testing, I think that situation will change and they'll say, oh, let's do antibody testing now because now it's endemic and there's immunity everywhere.
All right. There are two related questions here. Can you comment on some hospitals requiring healthcare workers to do PCR tests prior to return to work? And for resident doctors and nurses in hospitals, how often should they be tested? From Alexander C.
All right. So I think that testing of, doctors really don't like to be tested. Okay. I was tested. It wasn't a pleasant experience, I assure you. So my nose hurt after the test. But really, it goes with the not just with the territory, of course, but it goes with the thinking of risk-based testing. So we have to do it, actually. We really have to be tested. And how frequently should we be doing that? There's a math to this. Some say 3 weeks is good. Anything longer than 3 weeks is probably not going to be useful given the cycle of symptoms, okay? Because they're looking at symptoms. 14 days, to extend that by another 1 week, you should be able to catch anything that develops. So you test every 3 weeks, you're able to catch the development of COVID in a patient who's constantly exposed to the virus. Okay? So that's the thinking into why some do it every 3 weeks at the most. Some do it every week.
Every
that's
week?
That's also useful. But no longer than 3 weeks, I think.
All right. Here's another very interesting question. She's with ANCX, Bam Abelion. You talked about testing employees with high exposure to people, customers. to people and customers. Should we test delivery personnel, Grab, Lalamove drivers? How risky are food deliveries in terms of transmission? People have their stuff delivered more often now because they think it's safer. Is it?
I would term them as probably belonging to medium risk, so I would test them. That's my opinion.
And it has to be the PCR test.
Yes. Yes.
In regards with the food, when you have your food delivered, you always have to consider it being infected and exposed. So you should have proper sanitation. What are the practical ways? Is when you receive the food in their packages, before you enter your house or your room, you have to have ready plates there. Pour all the food on the new plates. Throw out all the containers that the guy brought in with. And you don't reuse it. Okay? Lalo na mga Tupperwares, you want to, but before you want to recycle it, but no, right now, no. You want to take it out. You want to dispose everything. And then before eating the food, I would suggest you to heat it or microwave it. You'll never know, the driver could have sneezed or the food handler sneezed. That's why we try to avoid takeout food for a while, actually.
Really? That's terrible.
That's how we want to protect ourselves.
My or wife, if you do, you have to remove them from the container. You can't eat from the cardboard box or the whatever receptacle it came in.
That's the old norm. That's the new norm now. You want to receive it. You want to transfer it to new containers. Consider the boxes as exposed, possible risk. And you want to throw that away as much as possible. Wash your hands right away. And heat your food that you took out.
Okay. Steve, if you want to call out anyone in Arturox, just do so.
Yes. There is a question. Brainerd is a businessman, a young businessman, and he's trying to, you know, he also has interest in laboratories. His business is in laboratories. I think it's a very good question.
For Dr. Dumo, good evening, Doc. Thank you for the talk. You were saying a while ago that it's best to ask people before we test for PCR, have you had any close encounter with a confirmed COVID patient, right? I was just thinking because I guess the general population with the amount that the PCR test is being charged at, and then we want to ask our workers who are getting, you know, parang ayuda from SSS, which is like 8,000 pesos, which is what the cost of a PCR test, maybe a little over that. Would it be better if we ask them, have you had any close encounter with anyone who has COVID-like symptoms instead for screening?
That's part of the questionnaire. In fact, if you look at sample questionnaires, because I didn't go into detail on the questions, that sort of question is included. So if, let's say, have you cared for anyone who was sick of respiratory symptoms and fever in the last 14 days? Ayan. So if the employee says yes, then you can test. Okay. So yes, you can actually do that and include such sort of questions, shifting from confirmed COVID. Rather, including in addition to confirmed COVID, yung mga COVID suspect.
In closing, I know there are still so much more questions. Perhaps we can just submit them to you, Doc, and email the question right to you. But in closing, I'd like you to address this. Are you saying that the strategy of the presidential advisor on entrepreneurship, which has acquired all these rapid antibody tests, is wrong?
I think if the focus is solely on rapid antibody tests, I think it will be much better if we can also move on to rapid tests, which are not just for antibody. Because like I was saying earlier, there are rapid tests which do not test antibody. And they are available, and the data seems to be looking promising. So perhaps it's something they can look at. It's not going to be as simple as your pregnancy kit, your lateral flow test. These are not too reliable, but they require machines, but they are machines that you can really use in the clinic. So it's something that probably they can explore.
Has the government not consulted infectious diseases experts on the strategy to reopen businesses?
Oh, the IATF, I think, well, it includes Edsel, who's a colleague. So we're well represented in the IATF. And we have our president of the PISMED who's also joining the discussion. So what we can assure you is that while sometimes the guidelines, if you take a look at it on the surface, parang kulang ang explanation. If you ask around the IDs, the infectious disease folks, we would be able to explain in further detail why the guidelines look so. Okay, because you know, mahirap kasing ilagay yung rationale behind that. Yes, we're well represented, and I think they're doing a fantastic job.
All right. So I'd like to give the floor to Steve for some parting shots, and the last, of course, to you, Dr. Dumo, before we say goodbye. Steve.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for attending this session. Thank you, Cez. Thank you to the staff of ANCS. Thank you, sir, Dr. Dumo. Thank you for enlightening a lot. I guess some people we can't just satisfy because they think they were not doing anything. Okay, so again, we just pray that they'll be enlightened, hope their families are safe, and I hope they won't need our services soon.
All right, Dr. Dumo, some last parting words for businessmen who are really quite confused on how it is to reopen their businesses.
Okay, so I'll just say that reopening businesses is not in conflict with infectious diseases. We just have to be systematic. It's always risk benefit. Okay, which activity should I systematically adopt? And what's its benefit versus the risk? The benefit of identifying potential patients in my workforce versus the risk of cost and other things. So not including the fact that if you test negative, does it really tell you the person is negative? Because tomorrow may be an entirely different matter again. So it's something you need to discuss as a company. It's certainly okay with infectious diseases for you to reopen. You don't even have to test everyone. But we suggest that if you do have to test, consider what we just discussed, which is test those that are high risk. And everyone else can come in much later, okay, if you have to test. So good luck to everyone and keep safe. If you have questions, though we are few, kaunti lang ho talaga ang infectious disease, hindi kami masyadong kilala until SARS and then MERS-CoV, and we're not thankful for SARS-CoV-2, but suddenly nakilala ho kami. We're always around, no? If you want to consult us, we can certainly guide you in how you reopen your business.
Thank you so much, Dr. Dumo, Dr. Lim, for enlightening all of us. And of course, thank you to Art Rockers and your friends for joining this ANCX forum. Until the next one, so thank you once again and a good evening to all of you.